In the last video, I explained to you concepts behind responsive, adaptive, and fluid design. Today, I want to show you how to execute it from a practical perspective. I will be using Figma, since it's my primary design tool. But remember that the principles I will share with you are universal, so it doesn't matter what tool you will use. We will focus on our responsive approach, since it's the most practical and popular one. But before we start designing, we first need to establish our strategy. Should you start from a mobile device perspective and then scale the interface up to high resolutions? Or maybe you should start from the desktop and scale the interface down to accommodate mobile devices. Approach of scaling down interfaces is popularly known as graceful degradation or desktop first approach, while scaling up is known as progressive advancement or mobile first design. A downside to desktop first approach is that several interface elements do not adapt well to smaller screen sizes. Consequently, this degrades the visual appearance and functionality on smaller devices. A mobile-first approach encourages us to begin the design process for the smaller devices first, forcing us to optimize that experience. Whenever you can, and your project allows it, I think that the mobile-first approach is the way to go. Okay, so we are assuming that we focus on mobile devices first. We need to establish the lowest resolution that our design will handle. More precisely, we focus on the lowest width. We will do the same for the tablet and desktop views as well. The lowest width values will serve us as a breakpoint for our layouts. A breakpoint is the screen size threshold determined by specific layout requirements. At the given breakpoint range, the layout adjusts to suit the screen size and orientation. Then we need to establish our responsive layout grid, which is made up of three elements: columns, gutters, and margins. Content is placed in the areas of the screen that contains columns. In responsive layouts, column width should be defined with percentages rather than fixed values. This allows contents to adapt to any screen size. A gutter is the space between columns that helps separate the content. Gutter widths are fixed values at each breakpoint range. To better adapt to a given screen size, gutter widths can change at different breakpoints. Margins are the space between content and the left and right edges of the screen. Margin widths are defined using fixed or scaling values at each breakpoint range. To better adapt to the screen, the margin width can change at different breakpoints. For a mobile view, I will use 16 pixels for both margins and gutters, and 4 columns for content, with 375 pixels of maximum width for the breaking point. For tablet view, I will use 32 pixels for margins and gutters, 6 column layout, and 768 pixels as breaking point. Desktop, same sizes for margins and gutters, 12 column layout, and 1280 pixels of maximum width. As I define the three of most popular use cases, I now have a basic responsive layout grid that I can follow while designing. For most projects, that would be more than enough. Let's use the YouTube magic to design first layout. As you can see, I have populated the 4 column layout defined in the previous step with website content. Now I had to translate that layout into its tablet and desktop versions. Starting with 4 mobile columns, you can see how we can translate them to wider resolutions, populating and optimizing the layout further. This concept is popularly known as stacking or folding of layout, where you can imagine the desktop view encapsulating 3 of 4 column mobile views, and the tablet view encapsulating the same 4 mobile column content in its 6 columns. From this example, you can see that the most crucial aspect of responsive design is a proper definition of layout grids and stacking or folding behavior. If you have any questions or comments, please ask them in the comments section below. If you want to learn something else today, watch this video here. To the next time!